Good evening. Welcome to St. Raphael's Parish. As we celebrate our liturgies, for the safety of all in attendance, we ask that everyone wear a mask and follow social distancing during Mass. The readings and prayers for Mass are available on the St. Raphael's My Parish app. Please take a moment to silence your electronic device. Today's Mass intention is for the repose of the soul of Monsignor J. Bernard Cavalry. The celebrant of our Mass is Father Lou. Today we celebrate the 21st Sunday in ordinary time. Those who serve God have a place in God's reign. Please stand.
Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
Amen.
Good evening, everybody. I hope you all are excited for the very adventurous week we have in store for us. School's kicking off. We've got a couple tropical storms just floating out there to remind us that it's that time of year. And so as we kind of prepare our hearts for whatever may come this week, we take this time to be with the Lord, to allow him to restore us, to bring us more deeply into his peace, into his love, into his life. And so as we prepare our hearts to receive that grace, this Mass, let's just take a moment to call to mind the goodness that he's shown to us this past week, the times the Lord has been present to us, and to ask for mercy and forgiveness for the times that we've sinned. You were sent to heal the contrite of heart. Lord, have mercy. You came to call sinners. Christ, have mercy. You are seated at the right hand of the Father to intercede for us. Lord, have mercy. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life. Amen.
Thanks for your great gift.
Let us pray. O God, who caused the minds of the faithful to unite in a single purpose, grant your people to love what you command and to desire what you promise, that amid the uncertainties of this world, our hearts may be fixed on that place where true gladness is found. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen.
A reading from the book of the prophet Isaiah. Thus says the Lord to Shebna, master of the palace, I will thrust you from your office and pull you down from your station. On that day, I will summon my servant, Eliakim, and son of Hilkiah. I will clothe him with your robe and gird him with your sash and give over to him your authority. He shall be a father to the inhabitants of Jerusalem and to the house of Judah. I will place the key of the house of David on Eliakim's shoulder. When he opens, no one will shut. When he shuts, no one shall open. I will fix him like a peg in a sure spot to be a place of honor for his family. The word of the Lord.
Lord, your love is eternal. Do not forsake.
A reading from the letter of St. Paul to the Romans. Oh, the depth of the riches and wisdom and knowledge of God! How inscrutable are his judgments, and how unreachable his ways! For who has known the mind of the Lord, or who has been his counselor? Or who has given the Lord anything that he may be repaid? For from him and through him and for him are all things. To him be glory forever. Amen. The word of the Lord.
Reading from the Holy Gospel according to Matthew. Jesus went into the region of Caesarea Philippi, and he asked his disciples, "Who do people say that the Son of Man is?" They replied, "Some say John the Baptist, others Elijah, still others Jeremiah or one of the prophets." He said to them, "But who do you say that I am?" Simon Peter said in reply, "You are the Christ, the Son of the living God." Jesus said to him in reply, "Blessed are you, Simon, son of Jonah, for flesh and blood has not revealed this to you, but my heavenly Father. And so I say to you, you are Peter, and upon this rock I will build my church, and the gates of the netherworld shall not prevail against it. I will give you the keys to the kingdom of heaven. Whatever you bind on earth shall be bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven." Then he strictly ordered his disciples to tell no one that he was the Christ. The Gospel of the Lord. So for those of you who don't know kind of how priestly formation works, it's like a 7 to 9 year process, right? And so I was on the short end of that spectrum. I had already gone to the University of Florida and gotten a degree, so I had 7 years of education before I was ordained a priest. And you take just an obscene number of classes in that time. I think I was looking at my transcripts. By the time I graduated, I had something like 240 credits to get my kind of degree to become a priest. It was not worth the salary. But those classes, you kind of get used to, you know, like, so every morning you've got a morning of classes, but then very often you've got either the afternoon or evening class as well. And the morning, you're kind of used to that, right? Like, that's what I did at the University of Florida. You're kind of used to dedicating that morning to study and all that sort of thing. Evening classes were not that bad. They're usually kind of electives or sort of simpler material, and they're kind of fun because it was after everything was over. Afternoon classes were the worst, because it was just this block of dense class time set aside for that afternoon. And your mind is already fried from the morning. Other guys are going off to play soccer or Super Smash Brothers or something, and you just know you've got another, you know, 2.5-3 hours of class ahead of you for the afternoon. It was killer. And so I distinctly remember one class, my year 6 of 7 there in seminary. So I was going towards diaconate ordination at the time. And we're sitting there listening to a very good, but perhaps a little dry, religious sister teach us about moral theology. She was talking about JP2's adequate anthropology or something like that. And so the eyes are like starting to glaze over, right? You're feeling like the food that you ate for lunch and you're just getting tired. And so I can see it on my classmates' faces, like we're fading. And we hear at that moment in one of these classes, just sort of like this distant like rumbling of like excited footsteps. And so you start to see a couple guys perk up and it's getting louder and louder until we realize like, you know, one of our seminary brothers is being an idiot right now. And he's doing something weird and he's coming towards us. And our whole wall of the classroom is windows. And so you start to see the heads just kind of like expectantly like turn as the footsteps are getting louder and louder and louder. And then, whoosh, past our windows is not a seminarian, but a seminarian wearing an entire inflatable Tyrannosaurus Rex costume, the kind where it's like the face is in like the neck, and so the head is up here, and he's just kind of running, and the head is kind of bobbling along with him. And just like a second passes, more footsteps, and another one shoots past after him, like chasing him down. And there's this moment where maybe 5 seconds pass as the footsteps start to get quieter of just like stunned silence. The teacher has stopped teaching at this point, and we're all staring out the window, and it became one of those moments, what I would like to call a how did I get here moment, where I'm certainly sitting there thinking, like, Lord, like, what? Like, there's this mixture of confusion and annoyance, but also just pure joy, and you can tell, like, you can see on Sister Paula Jean's face as well, you know, like, I worked really hard to get a doctorate in moral theology. Like, how in the world did I get here to this moment just then? So this how did I get here moment. And of course, then, you know, we burst out laughing after that silence. We had to take a break and kind of come back to class in a little bit later. But there's these moments that happen in our life, right? I think we all have some sort of experience of just a how did I get here moment. And some of them, like the one I just described, are kind of just funny or weird or crazy, right? Others are more intense or maybe more difficult. You know, I remember a similar moment when I was about 6 years ago in my seminary formation, was working as a chaplain in Tampa General Hospital. And it was an overnight shift. And I was in a room with a patient who had no family and was unconscious and was taking his last breaths on this side of heaven. And just sitting there holding this person's hand who I did not know, just this 25-year-old kid in a collared shirt and a tie, thinking, Lord, how in the world did I get here? And then, of course, there's one of those big defining moments. Sometimes it's incredible, breathtaking, amazing, exciting. I think of my moment of ordination, where there's a moment where you're kind of facing the bishop as he's seated, and another priest comes and vests you for the first time. He kind of puts on the chasuble, he puts on the stole, and then they take you, and they sort of turn you around and just kind of show you off a little bit to the people who have gathered there. And they're applauding, they're joyful, and just sharing in this moment of joy. And I remember seeing, you know, my family members and friends and all of these different people who helped raise me when I was in preschool and were in school with me through most of my life, and then college and seminary, and just thinking that moment, like, wow, like, Lord, this is crazy. Like, how in the world did I get here? And so there's moments of joy, of pain, just confusion or weirdness in our life, where that moment where our brain just kind of zooms out for a second and looks at us just to make sure that it is, in fact, our life. It's like a double take, a freeze frame. In movies, sometimes it's like, I think of these 80s or 90s movies where the car is like shooting through the air and the main character turns toward the screen. Like, you're probably wondering how I got here. those types of moments in our life. And we hear a couple of those how did I get here moments in the readings today. We hear St. Paul, again, speaking to the Romans. We've been journeying through this book to the Romans, this letter to the Romans for a while. And he's saying, how inscrutable and unsearchable are the plans and the knowledge of God? And you can just think of Paul, who just a couple of years ago was one of like the most intense Pharisees, like scholars of the law, and was really devoting his life to rounding up and killing the Christians in his Jewish community. And now he's outside of his home country of Israel, outside of the Promised Land, wandering through all of these pagan territories to the heart of the empire that was persecuting his people, and he's preaching the hope and joy of Jesus Christ to these Gentiles, to these Romans. And so you can hear him when he says, you know, how inscrutable, how unsearchable that is the knowledge and plans of God. He's saying, like, listen, guys, I have no clue how I got here, of all people. I have no concept of how the Lord brought me to this moment. But how incredible is this gift? And he finishes, to him be glory and honor forever. There's this how did I get here moment that turns into a moment of gratitude for St. Paul. And then, of course, we have Peter, right, who has this momentous moment in our faith and in his life as Christ recognizes this gift of faith that he has, as broken as he might be, and says, yeah, you are the rock. I name you Peter, and I'm going to build my church starting with you. Here are the keys to the kingdom of heaven. Whatever you say or do on this side of heaven, I'll take on the other. And you can just put yourself in Peter's kind of shoes there. You know, in that moment, receiving that task from Christ, or in those moments when he's living out the reality of being the first pope, the first leader of the Christian church, he's saying, like, Lord, I was a fisherman. Like, I'm uneducated. I don't know how to do this. How in the world did I get here to making these decisions, to leading these people? Lord, this is crazy. And the truth is, like, it is crazy. You know, this is how the Lord works throughout history. You know, he doesn't work in this precise or perfect or efficient way. It's messy. It's almost nonsensical and almost scandalous at times, the way God chooses to work. He uses broken and sinful and sometimes just weird people to bring his light and life to the world. And this is not just for Paul or for Peter or in my life. You know, this is how God works in each and every one of our lives. And so my challenge to you, or my invitation to you this week, is here at Mass or on the car ride home or at some point this week, maybe think about what are some of those how did I get here moments in your life. You know, the times that were crazy, the moments that were difficult or painful, the moments that were breathtaking or amazing, but those moments that stand out to you as important or as memorable, to talk about them with each other and to pray about them, to share these with the Lord and ask him the question, Lord, where were you in this moment? And how are you using this to lead me to where I am today? How did I get here? In the midst of all the craziness that's going on in the world today and in our personal lives, Lord, how did I get here? How are you using me? And then as we look at these moments, as we see how the Lord has been active in our past, we start to recognize him in our present. And we get this confidence that he will be with us in the future. Like we said in the psalm today, he will never forsake us. He will never abandon us. We can start to get this confidence of a Paul or Peter who can look at just the craziness of the church around them, the strangeness of their life and their life's journey, and see how the Lord was leading them each and every step of the way to that moment. And we can echo the words of that first pope, the simple fisherman, Peter, that no matter where we go, he walks with us, and he is Jesus Christ. Son of the living God. Sisters, I invite us to stand as we proclaim together our faith in the Creed. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us men, for our salvation, he came down from heaven, and by the Holy Spirit was incarnate of the Virgin Mary, and became man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. I confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sins, and I look forward to the resurrection of the dead, and the life of the world to come. Amen. Relying on God's unfailing promise, we pray for the church and the world.
That church leaders and faithful believers practice charity and patience with one another, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That civil leaders resist temptation and root out corruption, focusing on good for of all people, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That those who know the gift of friendship and marriage remain constant in love through every trial, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That those who serve us in the military, as well as first responders, will be strengthened by our prayers and kept safe from harm, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That as school begins, students, teachers, and administrators will have an eagerness and desire to discover new ways to learn, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That those struggling from emotional, economical, and medical effects of COVID-19 will find strength in the companionship of a merciful God, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That the sick and injured of the parish find hope through their faith in God, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That those who have died find peace in the embrace of Christ. And for Monsignor J. Bernard Cavalry, the intention of this Mass, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer. Eternal Father, all power is yours to grant to your children. Hear the prayers of we, your servants, and ask that and grant that what we ask in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation, for through your goodness we have received the wine we offer you, fruit of the vine and work of human hands. It will become our spiritual drink.
Blessed be God forever.
Pray, brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father.
Lord, accept the sacrifice at your hands for the
O Lord, who gained for yourself a people by adoption through the one sacrifice offered once for all, bestow graciously on us, we pray, the gifts of unity and peace in your church. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord. For by his birth he brought renewal to humanity's fallen state, and by his suffering canceled out our sins. By his rising from the dead, he has opened the way to eternal life, and by ascending to you, O Father, he has unlocked the gates of heaven. And so, with the company of angels and saints, we sing the hymn of your praise, as without end we acclaim. Created rightly gives you praise. For through your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, by the power and working of the Holy Spirit, you give life to all things and make them holy. And you never cease to gather a people to yourself, so that from the rising of the sun to its setting, a pure sacrifice may be offered to your name. Therefore, O Lord, we humbly implore you, by the same Spirit, graciously make holy these gifts we have brought to you for consecration, that they may become the body and blood of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, at whose command we celebrate these mysteries. For on the night he was betrayed, he himself took bread, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you. In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. do this in memory of me. The mystery of faith.
When we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim your death, O Lord, until you come again.
Therefore, O Lord, as we celebrate the memorial of the saving passion of your Son, his wondrous resurrection and ascension into heaven, and as we look forward to his second coming, we offer you in thanksgiving this holy and living sacrifice. Look, we pray, upon the oblation of your church, and recognizing the sacrificial victim by whose death you willed to reconcile us to yourself, grant that we, who are nourished by the body and blood of your Son, and filled with his Holy Spirit, may become one body, one spirit in Christ. May he make of us an eternal offering to you, so that we may obtain an inheritance with your elect, especially with the most blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with blessed Joseph, her spouse, with your blessed apostles and glorious martyrs, with Saint Peter, with Saint Paul, with Saint Raphael, our patron, and with all the saints, on whose constant intercession in your presence we rely for unfailing help. May this sacrifice of our reconciliation, we pray, O Lord, advance the peace and salvation of all the world. Be pleased to confirm in faith and charity your pilgrim church on earth, with your servant Francis, our Pope, and Gregory, our Bishop, the Order of Bishops, all the clergy, and the entire people you have gained for your own. Listen graciously to the prayers of this family, whom you have summoned before you. In your compassion, O merciful Father, gather to yourself all your children scattered throughout the world. To our departed brothers and sisters, and to all who were pleasing to you at their passing from this life, give kind admittance to your kingdom. There we hope to enjoy forever the fullness of your glory, through Christ our Lord, through whom you bestow on the world all that is good. Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours, forever and ever. Savior's command and formed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, Peace I leave you, my peace I give you, look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever. Amen. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit.
and let us offer each other some sign of Christ's peace. Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those who are called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed.
I will come to you in the silence. I will lift you from all your fear. You will hear my voice. I claim you as my choice. Be still and know I am afraid. I am with you.
us pray. Complete within us, O Lord, we pray, the healing work of your mercy, and graciously perfect and sustain us, so that in all things we may please you. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. So just a couple notes. As I said at the beginning of Mass, a couple things happening this week. The first is that school is starting back up, and so I'm sure you guys have noticed the fence that has gone around the school campus. That means those gates are going to be closed during the school week while school is in session. So in the evenings and on weekends, they'll be open and you'll be able to enter the courtyard as normal. But if you do come for daily Mass or during the week, you're going to have to use the entrance over here to go around that main entrance of the church. So we ask for your patience as we just kind of journey into this new school year here. And hopefully we'll have some more signs of life here on campus, which will be beautiful. And then, of course, stay safe. Storm season, I've learned very quickly that this area floods very easily. So as we continue to drive on the roads and take care of ourselves, just to continue to keep each other in prayer. For those of you joining us from home, certainly praying for you. We ask you to keep us in prayer as well. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
And may Almighty God bless you, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Go in peace, glorifying the Lord by your life.